Muy buenas tardes a todos. Esta sesión será en inglés y español. Y entonces, para los que necesiten de traducción, porque tenemos ponentes en inglés y español, los aparatos de traducción los pueden coger. Good afternoon, everybody. This session will be in English and Spanish. So for those who need translations, we have both speakers from both languages. So for those of you who need devices, just please go ahead and get them, because we will use the two languages to work. Me gustaría solicitarles también que lleguen un poco más para acá, porque el salón es muy grande por el tema de la traducción. Entonces sería mejor si ustedes se pueden poner un poquito más para acá, para que estemos un poco más juntos. So if you could just move a little bit towards the center, this is a huge room because of the translation devices. So if we could stay just a little closer, would be great. And I will just start speaking in Spanish and we'll move it from there. Okay, bueno, quería empezar la sesión que tenemos es acelerando la respuesta sobre la resistencia a las drogas, tuberculosis y la agenda de resistencia antimicrobiana. Y bueno, les quería comentar diciendo que todos creo que ya saben que la tuberculosis es la enfermedad infecciosa que más mata en el mundo y también una de las enfermedades que es la principal enfermedad que, dentro del ámbito de la resistencia antimicrobiana. Y nosotros estamos aquí para tratar de ese tema. Tenemos parlamentarios y sociedad civil, porque la idea de esta sesión es hacer hablar las personas que están involucradas en esta agenda desde la perspectiva de los parlamentos y desde la perspectiva de la sociedad civil. Y como primero ponente quería invitar aquí al podio al diputado, honorable diputado Elías Íñiguez Mejía, de México, que es el anfitrión aquí de nuestro evento y que va a hablar un poco. Gracias.
Muy buenas tardes. Antes que nada, comentarles que me siento muy contento de que México, Jalisco, sea donde nos encontramos sociedad civil, parlamentarios, asociaciones civiles, médicos, instituciones, congresistas, todos con un mismo fin. Y el fin es, ¿qué vamos a hacer y qué estamos haciendo con la problemática que tenemos de salud pública en el mundo? Ya lo decía Cintia, el cual me gusta mucho no decirlo, pero sí entenderlo, que la tuberculosis, como ustedes saben, es la enfermedad que más gente ha matado y que, sin embargo, sigue el tabú o sigue la mala información de algunas personas en algunos países que creen que está erradicada o que ya no existe la tuberculosis en su país. Nosotros, los parlamentarios, hemos formado el Frente Parlamentario contra la Tuberculosis. Yo soy el copresidente, uno de tres. Uruguay, Perú y México somos los copresidentes del Frente Parlamentario de América. En este frente, la principal función del frente, pues es, ¿cómo le hacemos los parlamentarios para cambiar nuestras políticas públicas? ¿Cómo le hacemos los parlamentarios para adecuar las políticas públicas, nuestras leyes en cada uno de nuestros países, para poder sacar adelante el problema de la tuberculosis? La abogacía política de cada uno de nuestros países es la obligación de cada uno de los parlamentarios que formamos el Frente. El Frente cuenta con, en América, cuenta con gente muy valiosa como la Secretaría Técnica, pero además con muchos apoyos tanto de la sociedad civil y con asociaciones civiles. En el Frente Parlamentario nos hemos puesto a trabajar. Yo les decía a mis compañeros parlamentarios de América que México, Uruguay y Perú, siendo los más antiguos, teníamos que haber ya hecho algo más contundente. Y hemos podido Por ejemplo, en Perú ya hay una ley contra la tuberculosis. Esa ley donde aclara y especifica que debe haber un fondo específico para la tuberculosis. Pero no nada más es tener el fondo. En muchos de nuestros países tenemos que ver que se etiquete ese recurso, pero además de que se etiquete, ver en qué proyecto y cómo lo vamos a aplicar, darle seguimiento y vigilar el recurso. Porque si nosotros como parlamentarios no entendemos que además de ponerle dinero, tenemos que hacer vínculo con las sociedades civiles, con la Unión, con el Fondo Mundial, pues no vamos a poder lograr un gran avance en la problemática que tenemos. En México, me voy a México, bueno, la lucha en la prevención y el control de la tuberculosis se debe de apegar plenamente a la norma que ya tenemos ahorita vigente, lo que implica que tiene que estar reportado en una ley. En México sí dice y está escrito que en la Ley General de Salud, en el artículo 1, hay una protección a la salud, pero también es un derecho que tenemos, el artículo 4 en México, es un derecho que tenemos a la salud todos los mexicanos. La prevención y el control de enfermedades transmisibles también tiene recurso, pero independientemente que en México, igual que en otros países, hemos cambiado la ley, seguimos con una grave problemática. Muchos de ustedes podrán pensar que en México estamos muy bien. Ustedes ya conocieron Guadalajara, los que tienen la oportunidad de conocer otras ciudades, podrán decir en México, pues es un bajo índice de tuberculosis. Y la verdad que no. En México tenemos de 20.000 a 30.000 casos nuevos reportados al año. Pero lo más complicado y lo más delicado es que tenemos de 2.500 a 3.000 muertes por año. Se nos sigue muriendo gente. Y lo más complicado para mí, como médico de profesión, pero como diputado, como político, es hablar el idioma de los demás parlamentarios. En la Cámara de Diputados somos 500 diputados, pero solamente 10 somos médicos. Y yo quiero felicitar a la sociedad civil, a gente, a mi amigo de Panamá, muchas gracias, a gente de todos lados, porque gracias a ellos hemos podido lograr sensibilizar a los que no son médicos, pero independientemente que no sean médicos, a los demás parlamentarios para que puedan entender la problemática de esta enfermedad. Que puedan sensibilizarse ante todo lo que tiene que pasar un paciente con tuberculosis, ante las dificultades psicológicas, emocionales, económicas, la falta de accesibilidad a los servicios, la falta del medicamento, la falta muchas de las veces de esa sensibilidad y voluntad que tenemos los políticos. La verdad que en la Comisión de Salud de mi país, que la verdad me da mucho orgullo presidirla, hemos estado trabajando desde que formamos el Frente. El Frente Parlamentario en México se formó aproximadamente hace un año. Y en este frente, lo primero que hicimos fue decirle al gobierno federal que íbamos a ser unos aliados, decirle a la sociedad civil que no estaban solos, decirle a las asociaciones que contaban con nosotros para poder sacar las políticas públicas y más el recurso. Primero hicimos un punto de acuerdo muy contundente, firmado por los 500 diputados hacia el gobierno federal, donde nosotros pretendíamos que se pusiera más énfasis, más recurso humano, más recurso económico y que no hicieran a un lado el problema de tuberculosis. Pero además, nosotros fuimos a la cumbre del G20 en Berlín, donde tuve la gran oportunidad de conocernos a varios de ustedes, y hicimos una carta al presidente de la República donde le pedíamos que cuando estuviera en la reunión de jefes de Estado en el G20, subiera y se comprometiera a que le iba a dar seguimiento y a que iba a invertir más, no a gastar, porque normalmente decimos es que gastamos tanto en el tema, gastamos en salud. De verdad se los digo, el invertir en salud no es un gasto. El invertir en salud es mucho más que nada más dar un medicamento o ver una enfermedad. Yo, además de ver números en la Cámara de Diputados, veo vidas. Y no podemos estar perdiendo vidas por falta de dinero. No podemos estar perdiendo vidas, perdiendo gente, cuando es una enfermedad que tiene cura. Cuando tiene cuando una enfermedad tiene cura, pues entonces, ¿qué tenemos que hacer? ¿Qué tenemos o cómo tenemos que sensibilizar a los gobiernos de nuestros países a que inviertan más en lo que se necesita para salvar estas vidas? La carta que le mandé al presidente no la voy a leer, solamente se las voy a resumir un poquito, pero sí yo le pedía, junto con mis 499 compañeros, que el reconocimiento de la tuberculosis, droga resistente como un componente central de la amenaza mundial, que representa la resistencia ante los antimicrobianos, pero además que teníamos que integrar esta enfermedad en las intervenciones de AMR o antimicrobianos. Teníamos que apoyar las estructuras para acelerar el desarrollo de regímenes de tratamiento que son urgentes, necesarios. Y lógicamente, el apoyo por parte del gobierno mexicano a la resolución, no de los diputados, a la resolución de la ONU para una reunión de alto nivel sobre la tuberculosis en el 2018. Recibimos contestación. Tuvimos reunión con los encargados del programa, tuvimos reunión con el propio secretario de Salud, el cual tiene la sensibilidad, y decirles que yo estoy muy contento porque en estos días, nosotros iniciamos el día lunes los parlamentarios sobre este tema, sobre tuberculosis, y hemos visto experiencias de la sociedad civil. Las hemos escuchado, hemos platicado y hemos intercambiado lo que hemos hecho cada uno de nuestros países. Se han comprometido los que no tienen el frente parlamentario a formar ese frente parlamentario. Nos hemos comprometido a que el presupuesto de egresos, que estamos a días de votarlo en diferentes países, salga con más dinero el tema de la tuberculosis. Pero algo importante, nos hemos comprometido a trabajar con la sociedad civil de la mano con la Unión, muy de la mano con el Fondo Mundial, y lo principal, yo estoy convencido que nada más hay una manera de poder sacar adelante y poder llegar al 2030 sin tuberculosis. Y esa única manera que es trabajar en equipo. Si trabajamos en equipo y cada uno hace lo que le toca desde su espacio, estoy convencido que lo vamos a lograr. El Fondo Mundial, y esto lo comento con un tema no de reclamo, pero sí hay una lámina que en el Fondo Mundial donde el 4% del Fondo para Tuberculosis, el 4% que da el Fondo Mundial a todos, solamente el 4% va para América. La invitación es, como buen político, gestionar para que ese porcentaje suba. El Fondo Mundial me decía que es un 4%, pero que implica miles de millones de dólares. Pero sin embargo, es insuficiente porque seguimos teniendo problemas. Con el compromiso de que los gobiernos de cada país también tienen que aplicar y tienen que destinar dinero. No nada más podemos estar a la espera de estar pidiendo dinero al Fondo Mundial o de estar pidiendo dinero a la Unión. También los gobiernos tienen que poner su granito de arena para poder sacar el problema adelante. Yo concluyo, discúlpenme, me dieron 10 minutos, parezco diputado, hablo. Ya voy a concluir. Y concluyo diciéndoles que los parlamentarios seguiremos trabajando porque es nuestra obligación. Espero que los parlamentarios de los países que no han formado el frente rápido lo formen y que la sociedad civil, le vuelvo a reafirmar, a la sociedad y a las asociaciones civiles, que no están solos, que hay diputados igual que ellos, que somos padres de familia, que somos hermanos, que somos tíos, que somos hijos, y que no queremos, que no nada más nuestros familiares, que no queremos que nuestra población se enferme más de una enfermedad curable, como es la tuberculosis. Así es que nuestro lema debe de seguir siendo juntos, juntos todos, para el 2030 tener un mundo sin tuberculosis. Muy buena tarde para todos.
Muchísimas gracias, honorable diputado Elías. Es muy, muy bueno saber que las Américas, una región que por mucho tiempo la tuberculosis no ha sido agenda in the World Health Agenda, in the perspective of the how is it, it's included in the agenda of the Global Ministerial Conference and the High Level Meeting on Tuberculosis. And thank you very much for that. It's my pleasure to introduce you now to our next speaker, Mr. Serhiy Kirill. He is a Ukrainian member of parliament and member of the Global TB Caucus. He is the rapporteur of a report recently initiated by the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe on the impact of AMR, in particular MDR-TB, in the European and Central Asian region. Mr. Kirill has also been leading on the establishment of a Ukrainian parliamentary interfaction platform on TB and on the group that was launched on the 3rd October in the Ukrainian parliament in partnership with local and regional civil society, in particular the Alliance for Public Health Ukraine, who is the civil society focal point for the Global TB Caucus in the country. You have the floor now. Thank you very much.
Hello? Yes? Oh, okay. You hear me? It would be good also to know how to switch presentations. Are you? Oh, okay. Thanks. Good day, everyone. My name is Serhiy Kirill, as was already introduced. I'm a member of parliament from Ukraine, and I want to try to answer this question, in fact. How did I get here? The reason this question came up to my mind is that I'm not a doctor, so I'm not a healthcare specialist. TB is something new for me, as nobody in my family has ever had TB. But I am engaged and involved in as a policymaker right now in this. And I was thinking maybe it will be interesting for many of you, particularly those who come from different countries and who wonder, how do we access politicians? How do we make sure that policymakers pay attention to TB? What are the triggers? Of course, I don't have the right answer, but a little bit of the background here on Ukraine. Ukraine is, as you know, many of you, in a very difficult situation right now. It's a big country in the heart of Europe, which is currently in war with Russia, and it's not the first time. Throughout its history, we were torn between different empires, Austro-Hungarian Empire and Russian Empire. And that, of course, has had an impact on the mentality and the culture of the Ukrainian society, which is, for the most part, not really proactive, very much ready to listen to who is the boss, you know, who is on the top. And, well, the politicians, the policymakers have to take this into account. So how, in this kind of environment, you make sure that issues like TB, when you are fighting a war, when you have people fighting and dying in the east, in Ukraine, when you have 7% of your territory annexed, being paid attention to by the government, by the parliament, by the policymakers. And the TB is a big problem in Ukraine, as you all know very well. The politicians, of course, are different, but in Ukraine, we are lucky to have a new era of politicians coming into play right now. These are the people which were elected to parliament after the last revolution in Maidan, And these people are different from the conventional generation. And this is very important also to understand. They have a lack of experience, but they are at the same time ambitious. They're open to innovation, very important. They're keen on working with the civil society. They use a lot of technology, like social media as well, in their work. So what triggers can, I mean, did affected me and made me get involved and can be also of use in many other cases. Of course, as I said, many of them are very ambitious. So any supranational initiatives can work because they want to be associated with that. With a strong civil society backing, this is extremely important to have an understanding that you will be supported. Of course, the opportunity to make a real change. These are not the people that will just sit and you know, get paid and do nothing. They want to have a real change and to have to write about it in everywhere and talk about it. There is no conflicting interest, vested interest, because they have lack of experience and, of course, lack of understanding how these interests work and can be burnt out quite quickly. And the last point is, of course, the ANC activity, a study, a report, or a project in progress that they can kind of jump in and be involved in right away. So this is what actually made me step in into this game and what we have so far. And I've been there only for the last several months. I have been appointed as a rapporteur by the Council of Europe Parliamentary Assembly, and we have already had a fact-finding mission to organize to Azerbaijan, where I had a chance to learn how TB is being treated in the penitentiary service in particular. We have recently set up a caucus, we call it a parliamentary platform to fight TB in the Ukrainian parliament, and I want to say you that attempts have been done before, but unsuccessfully. We have signed a declaration, and the Minister of Healthcare, civil society representatives, and MP have undersigned it to combine efforts for joint action. We have a plan to hold the RADA, the parliamentary hearings, next year, hopefully before the UN General Assembly meeting. We have also had the Minister of Healthcare already committing to the UN General Assembly deadline for the preparation of Ukrainian National Action Plan for that, which is, I think, extremely important because once you have a deadline with the government, it's very difficult, but once you have it, have their commitment, that means that you can control them and have additional pressure so that they deliver. And of course, I'm here now in Mexico. It's my first time here, and I enjoy this country. I'm very excited. So these are some of the media coverage, very important for politicians. We have also created a parliamentary platform, caucus, web page and Facebook page, where everyone can put in and provide their feedback. This is extremely important to ensure that there is accessibility between the civil society, people, patients, and we have a number of patients associations, to the high level of the politicians, so that they also have this confidence that they can communicate and can deliver. So what are the success factors, in my opinion? First of all, we have to understand that we are living in the information age. And as Alec Ross, which is a former Obama administration advisor on technology, said in his book, the data is like iron in the iron age, and data in the information age is the raw material. So you have to work with data, you have to work with technology, you have to work with social media in order to access policymakers and politicians and get them involved, interested. Go regional, but not only national. One of the things we are talking about, and I will definitely want to look into it in my report, is to get municipalities involved. Municipalities, their role in tackling whether it's climate change problem or TB problem is very often overlooked. 90% of people live in municipalities, so we have to be more active in working with association of municipalities. Every country has them, between the policymakers and these associations, and also push the governments to decentralize, whether it's funding or responsibilities, whether it's social services or psychological care, from the central level to the municipal level, where municipalities often have the infrastructure in place. The role of civil society, and Ukraine is a very clear, I think maybe even best example, particularly of the last revolution of dignity of 2013, is very important, because they are more trustworthy than any conventional institutions or governments. They are a source of expertise, and for the most part they are independent, not all of them, of course. You have to be very clear of their sources of funding, and they are very good at horizontal communications and at advocacy. So some people think that money is important, but definitely not for me. For me, in getting involved as a policymaker and partnering with civil society and the government, trying to do some work in this direction, is the ambition to make a real change. And I see that in TB, and my colleague from Mexico has just confirmed that, there is a possibility to make a change. It's not always about research and development, medication, but there's so much work that needs to be done in terms of the policy making, the health, the approach to treating TB, the monitoring of the patients, providing social care, psychological care. This is not about money. This is about the changes from the conventional approach to a more modern based approach. To learn a new field, so it's always good to have a challenge. It's also an opportunity to build a new network, but it's also for those who are in this, like the Global TB Network or the other organizations which are specialized on TB, to access my network, which many people, whether they are members of parliament or government representatives, have never heard anything about TB, nothing to do with TB, and it's good through me to be a communication channel between these networks and the network I'm involved in my daily activities. And of course it's excitement. So you see there's no money in that list. There's nothing about that. So to sum up, what you need to have, you don't need to be smart or rich to trigger the policymaker or get him involved in this process. Simply do it. But you will have definitely high chances if you approach the policymakers, particularly in such countries like Ukraine, Central and Eastern European countries, the post-Soviet bloc, that represent the younger generation. They are more open, they are more ambitious, they like challenges, and they definitely are more responsible. Engage civil society. Visit regional continental cooperation bodies. The way I got involved is through the Global TB Caucus, who approached my colleague, the head of the Ukrainian delegation within the Council of Europe, who then asked me to pick up the topic and submit a motion for resolution within the Council of Europe, because I'm a member of the Social Affairs and Healthcare Committee within the Council of Europe. And that's when it all started, through this networking and communication, now giving a certain result. Of course, be ready to support if you're an expert or civil society representative. And remember, he, she is a politician. So media coverage, social media coverage of the events has never been excessive. So that's very briefly, I think, I gave some, maybe thrown out some ideas and ready to comment and discuss later on. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this inspiring presentation and for the excellent work you're doing in Ukraine and in the Eastern Europe region. Thank you very much. So now it's my pleasure to present Ms. Yulia Chorna, who is going to speak about engaging civil society in high-burden countries ahead of the Russian Ministerial Conference and the UN High-Level Meeting on TB. Yulia is the TB Advocacy Manager at the Alliance for Public Health in Ukraine. The Alliance is one of the TB Regional Eastern Europe Central Asia Project partners through the TB Europe Coalition, involved in the coordination of the component of the regional civil society advocacy in 11 countries of the Eastern Europe and Central Asia. Yulia's areas of professional expertise since early 2000s have been closely intertwined with the health and social-oriented civil society organizations in Ukraine. Yulia has a master's degree in social work with a focus on community organization, policy planning, and administration from Syracuse University. The floor is yours, Yulia.
Good afternoon. It's a pleasure and an honor for me to represent civil society in this panel. My presentation will be about what and how we should do and why we could cooperate together with members of parliaments, together with other stakeholders for the goal of ending TB. So as a civil society, I would like to start with the importance of community mobilization. Because in all the processes going in the countries, in preparation to high-level meetings, it is very important to bring as many stakeholders as possible, both to raise the awareness about all these processes and to create joint common messages and joint actions. So for us as a civil society, there is a sense of urgency. We already had heard a lot of statistics and tendencies in tuberculosis. I would like also to briefly outline some bit of it is, because for us it's really a call for actions and the sense of urgency. So antimicrobial resistance is a global health security threat, and it is already been on the high-level political agenda, including IMRH high-level meetings and G20s. And as I represent the European region of Eastern Europe and Central Asia, for my region, the issue of drug-resistant tuberculosis is a critical one, and when worldwide it constitutes one-third of all MR-resistant cases, in Europe, according to UK review on IMR, it is central to antimicrobial resistance. So why to engage with civil society and how to collaborate? Sergei has already mentioned in his presentation it is important to make these bridges. And when we speak about high-level meetings, both Moscow and New York one in 2018, when we speak about it, we sometimes think about it in silos. Civil society has somewhere, and high-level meetings is something else. And there is a gap between both actors, because for civil society sometimes it is also not very clear why it is important to engage, what should be messages, how the situation for them in the countries will change if we participate. So civil society representing both non-governmental organizations and representing patient activist groups and citizens, basically they do a lot at the country levels, both in prevention and detection of new cases, providing peer-to-peer support services and fighting stigma around people who are affected by tuberculosis. They do advocacy, of course, and of course they are well suited for partnerships at the national levels. They are not acting in silos. Very critical is cooperation with national TB programs, with ministries of health, with members of parliaments, and civil society is also a resource for data collection. So that's why civil society should be involved in all the high-level meetings processes, from the starting of planning to participating and then to monitoring how actually the meeting, how actually the decisions which are made at such high-level meetings then implemented in the countries. What is the accountability? What is done after the commitments are taken by the heads of states? So for us now we have almost 1 year in preparation for UN high-level meeting, and it's very important to secure this bridging between high-level meeting processes and between civil society grassroots activism. And we can do it through community mobilization. I would like to highlight importance of regional and global networking for civil society, because myself, I'm based in Ukraine. I work for an organization called Alliance for Public Health, but Alliance also belongs to the wider networks, including TB Europe Coalition, which is a network of activists and organizations active in the region, in our region. So through access to the networks, we could really engage more civil society representatives in order to have a consensus about the most important messages and in order to ensure that the voices of people directly affected by TB are heard when the important decisions about effective TB care and about actions needed at the country level are made. Another important issue which was already highlighted by Mr. Kirill is cooperation with the networks of parliamentarians. We cooperate closely with Global TB Caucus, and the Alliance is a focal point at the country level, representing the civil society working with Global Caucus and working with the members of parliaments. So basically, we were very much engaged in creation of the Ukrainian TB Caucus platform and providing support necessary for that. So what we would achieve is a civil society as a part of the processes of preparation of high-level meetings. First of all, for the civil society representing the people, it will be empowerment, being a part of the processes. It will be insurance of accountability after the meetings are over and decisions are started to be implemented in the countries. It will ensure sustainability also, because civil society stays active, they act at the country levels, and this is very important for the response. For that, what is done, the people are brought together to the forums like that and to other meetings, and representing the civil society, it is also very important to provide the grassroots support to their activism and activities on different projects, including the regional projects. And then it is very important to have the common messages to be able to voice up these messages for the political declarations, which will be prepared by the countries in advance of the high-level meetings. I would like also to give you a brief example of a recently created panel, which is called Affected Communities and Civil Society Coordination TB High-Level Meetings Advisory Panel. It operates with the support of ICSS and Stop TB Partnership, and it now includes 15 members representing civil society all around the globe, including myself. So what is planned for the work of this panel? There will be a campaign throughout 2017-2018, which would ensure all these issues I mentioned before, like representing the voices of civil society in the outcomes of high-level meetings. And it will include in-person preparatory meetings, it will include calls, we will do the follow-up and reaching out throughout the region, throughout different members of different regional networks. And we will produce communication and advocacy materials. There are plans for accountability and lobbying weeks when the civil society would really meet with the representatives of UN missions to make their voices heard and to do the messages. And there will be processes post high-level meetings, which is, as I already said, are the critical, because it's really about accountability, about implementation, and about making all the promises happen. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Yulia, for this inspiring presentation and for the work you've been doing in civil society in raising the voice of civil society and working in your region from your perspective to make a change. It's my pleasure to introduce you, a personal friend of mine, Enrique Delgado, who is going to talk about the human impact of drug resistance tuberculosis. Enrique is a member of, is a focal point for the America's TB Caucus from Panama. In 2009, Enrique contracted XDR-TB. In order to survive, Enrique had a lobectomy plus 7 years of treatment in 4 different countries. While undergoing treatment, Enrique became a member of several NGOs as an advocate and advisor on TB. He also joined civil society organizations across Latin America to promote and fight for a good health system, patients' rights, and medicine supply. Enrique has a bachelor's degree in economics and is a master's in finance from Venezuela, but he currently lives in Panama. He's a patient advocate for TB Project LATAM Spain. You have the floor.
Well, good evening, everyone. Buenas tardes a todos, todas. Es para mí un honor estar aquí. It's a great pleasure for me to be here. And thank you for your time, for your commitment with the TB cause. The presentation, I'm going to present some slides and make some speech. So I prefer pay attention to the speech. So I'm going to pass the slides slowly, right? Well, my name is Enrique. I belong to the 20% of people who have survived extensively drug-resistant TB. I have lived for 7 years with the disease and traveled 4 countries finding the cure. By the year 2009, I used to work in Panama in a multinational electronics company. Because of the nature of my job, I used to travel a lot all over Latin America and the Caribbean. In September 2009, after a busy schedule of trips, I started to feel weak, night sweating, and all the other usual symptoms that you already know about the TB. But it was an intense pain in my back that makes me go to the doctor. A chest x-ray shows a cavity on my right lung with the size of a 25-cent coin, like this size, approximately. Immediately, I have to be hospitalized and start the treatment, in this case, a category 1 regimen. I was declared cured in February 2010, but in April, I relapsed with the TB symptoms and confirmed by smears. At that time, the diagnosis capacity, availability of drugs, and experience of MDR TB management in Panama was scarce. As I didn't have access to drug susceptibility testing, I was empirically prescribed with some drugs plus new ones as moxifloxacin and clarithromycin. Neither moxifloxacin nor clarithromycin were provided by the Panama National Program of Tuberculosis, and I had to search by myself the best options to buy them. I started to live alone and work from home to reduce the risk to infect others until smears were negative. However, my fear, it was increasing about that, no matter negative results. In March 2011, I was declared treatment failure based on sputum smears and a chest x-ray. So I decided to make me a right upper lobectomy, knowing that will not be the solution, but reduce some bacillus in the lung. So the surgery took 7 hours. Upper lung was totally damaged. At the time, I knew I have to search other options for the treatment in another country. And I find out that Peru was a good choice. I contact some doctors of the national program in Peru, and their willing to help was really amazing. I traveled to Peru in May 2011. Of course, my culture were negative at that time. And the NTP, the national program, offered me MDR treatment that was available for me. I had to live in Peru almost 4 months, but it was responding good, this treatment. In this slide, there is a timeline for the whole process. I'm gonna stay with that slide so you can see it as I'm speaking. Well, unfortunately, Coulter's result shows that I was resistant to almost everything, declaring XDR TB. Despite that, and for the difficulties to make an XDR treatment due to medicines availability, and hospitalizations, also expertise management. I continued with the MDR treatment at that time. During 2012, all bacteriology results were negative, but I faced a great problems with the medication shipments, drug purchase, and expiration dates of the medicines in Panama. Finally, in May 2013, after daily injection for 8 months and nearly 22 months of almost daily nausea and vomiting, among others, psychological, emotional, and physical symptoms, I was declared cured by them. In October 2013, I was invited to the Union World Conference that was held in Paris to present my experience as an XDR survivor and the support that my company, my work, gave to me. Unfortunately, again, in March 2014, only 1 year after being declared cured, a mild cough emerged. A little, but it was there. I got a CT scan, which showed minimal bronchial inflammation. Smear and cultures were negative. I was aware that the bronchoalveolar lavage samples yield superior performance, so I did it privately. Test indicates mycobacterium tuberculosis with rifampicin resistance, meaning a relapse after 5 years of physical, economic, and emotional desolation. I knew by then that I had XDR-TB because the results in Peru showed that, but the last treatment, it went well. I feel good, but something happened in them. So at that time, I contacted a physician whom I met in the Union Conference, and an increasing sterilizer regimen was needed based on the potential remaining effective drugs, plus at least one sterilizing drug, for example, linezolid or clofazimine. In addition to companion drugs, it would be imipenem, bedaquiline, or dilaminate. Reduced availability and bureaucratic limitations placed bedaquiline and dilaminate out of reach. The availability of medication plus high drug and hospitalization costs made treatment virtually impossible in Panama or Venezuela or Peru. But there was a chance in Barcelona, in Spain. Provided my still positive bacillary state in 2014, I exhausted the last resource of my family and traveled to Spain in search of a cure. The bacillary samples were cultured and DST showed that XDR-TB, resistant to moxifloxacin, micacin, and the other drugs. I was treated then with 24 months with capreosamine, levofloxacin, cyclosporine, and other medicine with linezolid. I need to stop after 6 months the linezolid due to severe paresthesia, which I still remain. That's for me to continue with another imipenem and clavulanic, and having a central line for 2 years. It was right on my chest. Receiving treatment in a supporting institution that calls a race clinic, to remain adherent and emotionally stable. However, loneliness, desolation, and guilt appear in any time. The drugs' side effects did not help. It is blaming patients for default, but when there is so much already lost and there is no clear future, the line for default is too narrow. Give up or even dying presents as an appealing solution. I want to, maybe if you want, close your eyes or just read it, but many times I think on that imagine yourself living away from your family to protect them. Imagine yourself thinking every day in how your family is doing or dealing without your economical support. Imagine yourself taking more than 15 pills or 20 pills every day at the same to carry an intravenous system to receive another medicine. Imagine yourself that some of this medicine affects your emotions, feelings. You feel sad, angry, worried, or mad. Imagine yourself trying to avoid feelings or questioning why this is happening. Now imagine dealing with all these things during 2 years, in my case more. Imagine telling your child, because I love you, I have to leave you. So it is what really, it wasn't easy. My treatment ended in July 2016. I'm already cured. I miss a part of my lung that will limit my breathing forever. I present paresthesia, and I will be, that's kind of funny, I'll be purple person for a while because of clofazimine. I make like a tropical tan, but it's not so hard to get. At least I'm not completely deaf. I met people who have a 100% loss of hearing, but the most important side effects are not visible. I had more than 200 days, cumulative days, under respiratory isolation. It was a horrible experience. I had suicide thoughts, almost break my willing to go on. I lost a precious time with my daughter. I lost my career, and my family struggled for a while financially. And I have to start over again to stabilize my life in many aspects. This is the team who collaborates with my health in Barcelona. This is a race clinic team. It's a very, very nice example of how do you treat the tuberculosis, not only with the medicines you need, but the human quality and how you have to treat any persons without very hard circumstances. I met person from all over Africa, from Pakistan, from Romania, from Ukraine, from Russia, from Ghana, from Guinea Equatorial, and they were loving and kindly with all these persons. My years fighting TB show not only how patients get tangled in the resistance spiral, but the many obstacles they must have to face because the health system are underfunded, ill-prepared, and not patient-oriented. Cures rates of only 20 to 50% are unjust, inefficient, and likely promote the spread of resistance. Given the consequences of the DRTB crisis, we need to work differently and invest much more in different levels. I would like to share these words and dedicate to all TB patients who fight the battle in their life with sacrifice and resilience. I have to learn a lot of that. To whom don't have a voice or any resource to ask for help, but with their hearts, humility, and willpower can win this battle. Gracias. Bueno, y que viva México. Quiero hacer una reflexión final. Soy fanático del fútbol. I like very much soccer. And como el diputado Elías dijo, parliamentary Elias said, we are a team. We are a team. And as a